Hi, good evening, everyone. I hope your week is going really well and everyone's having a lovely Tuesday. I'm fine, thank you. Thank you for asking. All right, I'm just gonna wait for a couple more minutes, so that more people join in and yeah. No, the giveaway results have not been announced.
Hi. Is it too much of light behind me?
I think a little bit. I think it's just
I'll just draw the curtains a little bit. Just give me 2 minutes, huh?
Sure.
Yeah, I think better now.
Yeah, much better.
Are you?
I think you're sorry. All right. So how are you doing, ma'am?
I'm fine, thank you. Thank you for having me on this Insta Live session.
It's a pleasure and an honor. So guys, good evening and welcome to our session. So today's session is super special, especially if you love reading, if you love writing or looking at a career in writing, then you're in for a treat as we have none other than author Kanchana Banerjee with us. She is the author of best-selling novels Nobody's Child and A Forgotten Affair. Besides that, she's also had a flourishing writing career as she's written for various publications across the country. So, Kanchana, ma'am, welcome to our live session. And we have a bunch of questions to you, as I'm super excited to talk to you. So, are you ready for the session?
Thank you so much. And it's a delight always to talk to readers and to kind of do sessions like these. And this comes close on the heels of my announcement about my third book, which I have put up on my Instagram. So I'm very excited, and because this is my third book after Nobody's Child, which was in 2019. So I'm very excited and eager to start the conversation.
All right. So first things first, tell us a bit about yourself. How has your journey towards becoming an author and to wherever you are right now, how has it all panned out?
Okay, so I'm very very odd and weird in this that while a lot of people discover their writing mojo along their lives and stuff, I've always known and I've always wanted to be a writer. I've never wanted to do anything else other than writing all my life. As far as I can remember, I've always wanted to write and get published. And to kind of become a published author was always my dream, ever since I was a child. And of course, it took a long time. I started with writing and working with various publications like Times of India, Telegraph, Statesman. This was 18, 20 years ago. And immediately after my graduation, I began working for Statesman in Calcutta. I've always been a features writer. You know, I'm not a business writer or a political writer. I've always been a features writer, you know, writing articles on relationships, on people, on social issues, on parenting, on, you know, art, entertainment, etc. And then I graduated to kind of working for various companies as a corporate writer, like Hindustan Lever, Procter & Gamble, UNICEF, etc. So I've been, you know, writing professionally for these, you know, companies and publications. I've done that for almost 18, 19 years. And it's in 2014 when I, you know, I landed up in Gurgaon. We used to stay in Bombay. And, you know, all these years while writing for companies and publications, I used to always constantly, you know, wonder when will I be able to write my book. But I guess, you know, destiny plans for you and plans for things to happen when they are meant to happen. And you can't, you know, even if you want, I mean, you know, want it to happen, I think there is always a time for something to happen. So in 2014, I began writing my first book. And then, you know, HarperCollins picked it up and it got published in 2016, followed by my second book, Nobody's Child, also with HarperCollins in 2019. And now 2021, my third book is coming out. This is not with HarperCollins and this is a self-published book. And, you know, we will talk about why I decided to go on the self-published route with this one in the conversation.
What was the feeling like when your first novel got published? I mean, although all your life you knew that you wanted to write, but somehow it didn't happen, like, you know, a book didn't happen. So how was it like when you finally saw a copy of your published book?
So, you know, it was, I think, the most emotional moment in my life, you know, when, you know, I had submitted and I got, you know, I submitted my manuscript to various publishing houses and many of them rejected the manuscript. And I was really worried, and then I was waiting for HarperCollins, Amaryllis and some other publishing houses to get back. And I was thinking that, you know, until then, these smaller publishing houses had refused me. So I was thinking there is no way these big publishing houses are going to take me. Pata nahi mera kya hoga. And I was so, like, you know, down in the dumps. So when I, you know, when I got my acceptance email from HarperCollins, oh my God, I just sat down and I, you know, I bawled and I cried. I cried my eyes out. You know, I was like so happy that, you know, a dream that I had, you know, kind of seen and nurtured ever since I was a child, it's coming true. It was a very emotional moment. It was a very emotional moment, yeah.
Right. And I'm sure once your first book came out, I'm sure that sort of led towards your second novel, you know, Nobody's Child. Mm. So tell us a bit about that one, because it is one of, you know, a really best-selling novel. So how did you come up with the plot and everything, and how has the response to that book been?
Okay, so, you know, Nobody's Child, the basic plot of Nobody's Child, it had been, you know, with me for a very, very long time. You know, as far back, you know, as in about 2002. So the basic plot is that of a girl who kind of, you know, confesses to having had sex before marriage to her newly married husband during her honeymoon, and her husband gets very upset, and, you know, he kind of drags her back to her parents' house and he humiliates her, he humiliates the family, and, you know, he kind of leaves her. So, you know, way back in 2002, I remember I had gone to a doctor's chamber with my son, who was then just about two and a half, three years old at that time. And, you know, and because I used to do a lot of writing on relationships and parenting, so whenever I used to get my hands on any magazine, I used to read the Agony Aunt columns. So in the Agony Aunt column, there was this letter from a young girl talking about this, that, you know, I was rejected by my husband, you know, on my while on my honeymoon because I got drunk and I confessed to having had sex before marriage. And now he wants a divorce. He doesn't want to live with me. What do I do? You know, I was so stupid. Why did I honestly tell him, you know, about this and that? So, you know, and at that, so, you know, this story, it stuck on with me. And actually at that point in time, I wrote a couple of articles, you know, on honesty in relationships, you know, how much honesty can a relationship really handle? And these articles came out in Femina, they came out in Deccan Herald, Deccan Chronicle, etc. This was way back in 2002, 2003. But, you know, somewhere this little letter, it stuck on in my head. And, you know, I had kind of told myself that someday I'm going to write a book about it. Because there was, you know, there's a lot of emotion and there's a lot of drama in this. But, you know, I did not use this story as my as the plot for my first book, primarily for the reason because, you know, I feel very strongly about the issue of domestic abuse and emotional abuse. And, you know, I have seen some of my friends, some of my very close relatives go through this. So that is what I wanted to write about in my first book. And when I sat down to writing my second book, you know, this is the plot that was in my mind. And because, you know, at heart, I'm a thriller lover. I just love thrillers. So, you know, instead of making it into a very plain and simple, plain and simple relationship drama, I kind of, you know, gave it a very thrilling and a chilling twist. I hope you read the book.
No, personally, I have not. But yeah, I would love to. I mean, you know, yeah. It's on
I
my list.
I hope you. If you like thrillers, you will love the book.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And how has the response to the book been? Like, you know, since
it was very good. That's what it was. It was very well received. In fact, I was a little worried because the main antagonist in the story in Nobody's Child is a woman. And her name is Kamini Pratap Singh, and she's you know, she's married, and she has a daughter, and she's basically a mother, but she's an extremely cunning, wild character, and I was a little worried that, you know, how are people going to, you know, accept a character like that, a woman who is so cunning and so scheming and so evil. But I think, you know, I think people like bad girls, you know, people took, you know, the readers, they just loved Kamini. They just fell in love with her, with the dark side of her character. And the book was very well received. It went up on the bestsellers list and it stayed on the bestsellers list for a long time. It sold very well and it made everyone very happy. Me, the publishers, everyone. So, yeah, it was a great feeling. I got very positive response to the book.
Awesome. So now coming to one of the most exciting questions, and I think all of our listeners are also eager to know. So what is your next novel on and when can we expect to, you know, have it in our hands?
Okay, so my next novel, so I'll just give you a little bit of a backstory. So the next novel, I'm self-publishing it, and the book is called Eye on You. It is a thriller set in Gurgaon. And before I tell you more about the plot, I'll tell you why, you know, after two successful books with HarperCollins, I decided to self-publish it. I decided to self-publish it for the only reason that most publishing houses, I was blocked creatively. I had a very bad writer's block all through 2020, which is why I could not submit, you know, my novel earlier. So by the time I finally got around to submitting my manuscript in the April of this year, 2021. So by then, you know, most of these publishing houses, HarperCollins, Penguin, Westland, etc., they have so much of backlog from the last 15 months because, you know, books have not been printed, shops are closed, etc. So, you know, they are, many of them are not accepting fiction because they believe that, you know, we have to clear the backlog before we accept more fiction. During this pandemic, more nonfiction is selling, so they're not accepting, you know, fiction. In fact, you know, some of my author friends who write romances, you know, they have been rejected and they've been told that, you know, romances are not selling now. Only nonfiction books are selling. And I don't write nonfiction. So, you know, I was told by two large publishing houses that, you know, if you want us to look at your book, you'll have to, you know, kind of wait for at least about a year. So about a year means 2022 middle, latter half. And I was not prepared to wait that long because, you know, Nobody's Child came out in 2019 and we are already in 2021. So I didn't want to wait for so long. And many of my friends are, you know, self-publishing their books. Andaleeb Wajid, Milan Vora, and many others, you know. These two, I take names because they're very close friends of mine. They have been published by big reputed publishing houses and, you know, they have gone ahead and self-published their books. And then, you know, some other authors, I kind of found out that during the pandemic, because of the situation that these publishing houses are in, they are, you know, they have kind of gone on KDP and they have published their next book. So I thought that why not try this route with this book and see how it goes. So which is why I decided to go for the KDP route. And now about the plot of this book, this is very topical and very very relevant to our current times. We are living in the times of social media, continuous posting on social media. We post pictures of ourselves with our friends in our house, in the balcony, etc. We're constantly posting all the time. So, you know, what often people don't realize is that we put out a lot of very personal information out, you know, on Facebook, on LinkedIn. And if someone begins to follow you, track you, watch you, they can get to know they can get to know your whole life. So basically, you know, your digital footprints, if someone decides to study your digital footprints, they can get to know everything about you by studying your digital footprints. And on the other hand, you know, advanced technology has become quite scary. We live in smart homes. Many people have smart doors which are operated by mobile apps. They have CCTVs operated by mobile apps, etc. So if, you know, on one hand, your personal private information is available to anybody and everybody, and on the other hand, your homes have apps that are, you know, things that are controlled by apps. So if someone hacks into your phone, they have all the access to you. They have all the access to more information about you, and they have access into your house. So, you know, if someone wants to hurt you, wants to ruin you, you know, it has become that much more easy. So, you know, this is the basic premise that, you know, someone has eye on you, you know, and that's why the name eye on you, that somebody is watching you, following you, tracking you and gathering information about you. So it's a very chilling thriller set in Gurgaon.
I mean, the name is so apt and I can't wait to read it. And when is it coming out?
So I will be uploading and publishing it in September. So September is my birthday month, and both my books, A Forgotten Affair and Nobody's Child, they both, you know, were kind of, they were both released in the month of September in the respective year. So I'm very superstitious about these things. So while it is completely ready, editing has been done, the book cover is done and everything is ready, but I'm going to, you know, upload it and publish it in the month of September. That's my birthday month. It's my lucky month. So in the month of September.
You have all our best wishes for that, and I'm sure this one is also going to do very well.
Thank you so much.
I really had goosebumps when you said, like, people can have eyes on you and can literally track every little thing that's going on in your life. And that's pretty true. So do you think that social media has become really negative in today's day and age, you know, with respect to how much hate and shame, especially like content creators and people who have an online personality, face on an everyday basis, and everyone as well? Like, so what is your take
on that? Yes, of course. Yeah, totally. So, you know, I think, see, you know, what happens is that, you know, we kind of pride ourselves as private people. We say we are very private, but then, you know, we put out almost anything and everything on social media. And, you know, I'm also guilty of that. I post a lot of pictures about me, my dogs, my plants, etc. out there. But, you know, and to write this book, I kind of, you know, I'm there on Instagram, I'm there on Facebook. I've been, you know, kind of studying, you know, a lot of different accounts of the younger generation. By younger generation, I mean mid-20s to mid-30s, that generation. They put out so much of intimate pictures, you know, personal intimate pictures out there, that, you know, it's really scary, you know, that they don't realize that, you know, someone with the wrong intention could be watching them, could be following them, you know, men and women. It's not just women. You know, there are also some men, you know, who are very much into fitness, who are very much into art or something. And they're constantly, you know, posting pictures about themselves, about the parties they're going to, about what they are doing. So, you know, I think, of course, you know, on one hand, there is a lot of negative trolling that, you know, constant people are getting criticized and, you know, nastiness is there. And on the other hand, you're you know, kind of doing things which is exposing yourself even more to, you know, these kind of negative, you know, more than negative, I would say that you are kind of, you know, actually putting yourself in a position where things could be dangerous for you. So you need to be careful about what you put out there.
Absolutely, absolutely. I agree on that. You know, having been an author and a woman yourself, have you ever received any sort of negative comments or derogatory messages personally?
Yes, I have sometimes. So the thing is that, you know, I'm quite tall and broad, and I'm not very narrow and thin. So I look broad, and I'm not. I don't fit into the stereotypical image of a very, very slender, slim figure. So I've been fat shamed. I've been called moti auntie and stuff like that. So, you know, of course it feels hurtful, but you know, these are just nasty, and I don't engage with people like that. And so, you know, yeah, I mean, there have been some, nasty comments, and you just have to, you know, you just, it irritates you. It rankles you for some time, and then you have to get over it. So.
I know that you mentioned briefly about having a writer's block, in 2020. Mm. So what are some ways in which you overcame them? And, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of aspiring writers and people out here who would want to know your tips and secrets of getting over a writer's block.
So, you know, first of all, I have to say that, you know, all my life, I've been a writer all my life, and I, you know, always used to scoff at people when I used to hear them say that, oh, I'm going through a writer's block. And I used to tell myself, you know, ye all ye sab bahana hai. This is all like excuses that people are making. So I stand corrected. I am sorry I said those things. Writer's block is very real. It is very true. And it is not an urban legend, and it is not an excuse that people make out of laziness. I'm sure there are some who probably make, you know, kind of make it as an excuse out of laziness, but it is very, very, it's a reality, and it is crippling. So, you know, and I, you know, my sympathies and my heartfelt sympathies for those who kind of, you know, who are probably going through it. And I hope it never, ever happens to a creative person, whether a writer, artist, singer, whatever. Because, you know, for a creative person not to be able to create, whether it is a painting, whether it is writing, whether it is singing or dancing or whatever the medium is, to be not able to create is almost paralyzing. You know, it kind of makes you feel, it makes you doubt yourself. I began doubting myself that, am I done? You know, I think I'm not going to write anymore. Nobody's Child was my second and my last book, and I'm not going to write anymore. And I was meant only to write two books. And it's not a good feeling. You know, it's a very scary feeling. And it is also a feeling which kind of eats you from inside. So, but the thing is that, you know, I'm surrounded by a lot of friends who thankfully have more faith, just a sec, who thankfully have more faith in me than I have in myself. So I reached out to them, and they, you know, they said that, listen, you know, the world is going through, you know, a very tough time. This is pandemic. And, you know, so Damayanti Biswas is one of them. Arjun Gend is another. And many others I reached out to. And they sent, you know, links to articles where, you know, writers all over the world, you know, were complaining that, you know, we are unable to write because we are. So, you know, what happens is, as a writer, you know, especially a writer like me, I soak in inspiration from external stimuli, from meeting people, going out for events, and etc. So when I'm shut in the house, I can't think. So I guess that's what, you know, kind of got to most creative people. So tip number one, don't give up. You know, try doing other things. Like I've almost turned my entire house into a nursery. There are so many plants in my house. So I took up gardening. I learned baking, and I put on a lot of weight because of that, because I used to bake and I used to eat, and, you know, try exercise, try yoga. So me and my husband, we took up cycling, just to go cycling when the lockdown eased, and etc. So try doing all that to distract yourself from the block that's there. But, you know, there's one thing that, you know, throughout the block, every single day I used to sit down with my laptop and try to do some writing. something. So don't give up. You know, hunt for writing prompts. Ask your friends to send you interesting writing prompts. Read about, read about writing. If you're unable to write, kind of equip yourself with the technicalities of writing. So I read a lot of very good writing help books during this time. And, you know, each of these, some of these good books, they all have exercises at the end of the chapter. So do those exercises. So, you know, what I'm saying is that don't give up. And the only way to tackle this problem is to take it head on and, you know, and through it. There is no skirting around it. So you have to butt your head through it and you have to get to the other side. And you will get to the other side. Just don't give up hope. That's all.
That's awesome. I think those are some lovely tips, and I'm sure people who are going through a writer's block, we hope you get through it and you follow these tips, and that can certainly help you. So I want to know, you've had a career of like over 2 decades, and so how have you balanced and juggled being a mother, a wife, and also a writer and author? Like, how have you found your work-life balance?
So see, the thing is, I've for the major part of my life, I have been a freelance writer. I gave up working for Times of India a long, long time back when my son was about 1.5, 2 years old. So, and I started writing. So as a freelance writer, you are pretty much, you're pretty much your own boss. So you can decide what assignments to take and when to take and et cetera. But having said that, I think it's very important to first discipline yourself. And if you discipline yourself and you tell yourself that every day in the morning at 9:30, I'm going to sit down and work, then what happens is the moment you discipline yourself, people around you also get disciplined. So my son, right from very young age, when he was 1.5, 2, he used to see that mommy, gets up in the morning, does some work, blah, blah, takes whatever, does this, that. And by 9:30, she's at the laptop working. So my son has grown up watching me work at home, and he knew, and I trained him, I taught him to kind of respect my work. Of course, as a child, he used to come and disturb me and etc. But then I taught, I kind of gradually got him into the habit of reading. He's a voracious reader, so he started reading. He would sit next to me and read. So you have to train yourself first. And if you get, if you become disciplined yourself, your family members also become, disciplined, and they start respecting your work time. So my maidservant, my kind of parents who would be calling from Calcutta, my parents, my in-laws in Calcutta. So they knew that, this is the time that Kanchana is not to be disturbed. So my husband, my son, everyone in the family, kind of follows that pattern. But the first thing is that you have to enforce the pattern in your life, because you can't be erratic and indisciplined ki kabhi subah likha, kabhi raat ko likha, kabhi sham ko likha, and expect others to follow. So if you become disciplined and if you set up a routine for yourself and if you stick to that routine, other people willy-nilly will also start following that routine.
Absolutely. I think self-discipline is the key over here. My last question for you is, do you have any words of wisdom or advice for all the aspiring writers and authors out there, who want to make a name out there and, have their books published? So what are your tips and your advice to them?
So first thing is that, if you think that you're going to make a name for yourself, then I think you're in the wrong profession, because this is not a profession where you kind of set out for glory, because there is a lot of hard work, and you have to prepare yourself for a lot of disappointment, for a lot of rejection. So this is not for the faint-hearted. So you have to be very strong, and you have to understand that you are creating something and putting it out in the world. So there will be people who will not like it. There will be people who will like it, and you have to take both with a pinch of salt and with graciousness, and and keep that in mind. So read a lot, read an enormous lot in the genre that you want to write, and of course outside the genre also. So read a lot, read the good writing help books. There are loads of very good writing help books. So read that, work on your craft and work on yourself, work on the story. And as I keep saying, that writing is not like running a sprint race. It's like a marathon. It's a long marathon. And, you know, and writing is a solitary journey. It's not a group activity. So, you know, and writing is something which you have to do every day by yourself, you know, sitting quietly. So, you know, make a small writing group, join a writing group, share your work, because, you know, there will be moments, you know, there will be time and moments in your in the journey of your writing the story where you will be stuck. You will not know whether to go this way or that way. Sometimes you will want some clarity on your plot. So that's when, you know, being part of a writing group really helps. So, you know, then you can discuss your frustrations, your anxiety. See, the thing is, you know, when you submitted your book, your manuscript to various publishing houses, and when you're expecting, you know, a reply, and you're, you know, keeping your fingers crossed for a positive reply, no matter how caring your family is, no matter how caring your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife is, they do not understand, they cannot understand the anxiety of continuously checking your Gmail and, you know, wondering, reply aya. So, you know, but this is something which another fellow author will understand, the anxiety. Ki, you know, reply kab aayega, itna din ho gaya, abhi bhi reply kyun nahi aaya, you know, will it be a yes? And if it's a yes, yay, but, you know, chances of no are a lot more than yes. And the crushing disappointment you feel, you know, when you receive a rejection, while of course I'm sure your family will hold your hand and, you know, will sympathize with you and will kind of try and, but they don't know how crushing it is to get a rejection note. But another fellow author, whether, you know, I mean, who's in the same boat as you, or who's probably got accepted. See, you know, I have two books behind me, but I know what rejection feels like. And, you know, and the way I will reach out and, you know, react to, you know, another person telling me that, you know, I got rejected will be very different from the way the person's family does it. So it's very important to kind of build your village around you. You know, you cannot do this on your own. You, of course, have to do a lot on your own. But, you know, it takes a village. And you need that village. So build that village around you. You know, that's very important. So, you know, I think read a lot. Read different things. Read very good, you know, good books in the genre. And read writing help books. And, you know, and build your village. Build your writing village to kind of hold you up and hold your hands and hold other people's hands, you know. You know, I mean, don't be selfish, you know. I mean, when you need help, if people are holding your hands, when they need help, you should be there to hold their hands too. So it works both ways. So I think, you know, these are very important.
Thank you so much for such wonderful tips. And guys, I'm going to request you all, if you have any questions for Kanchana ma'am, you can just put them in the comment section below and she'd be happy to answer them. I'm just checking a few messages, very sweet ones. Everyone's wishing you. Chavi is saying best wishes for the new book.
Thank you.
About your next book. Author Sanchali is saying good luck, Kanchana.
Thank you. Please do buy and read my book and let me know what, you know, when I publish it, what you think about it, what you feel about it.
Absolutely. We can't wait for September. And guys, if you want to know more about Kanchana ma'am, please follow her on her Instagram handle, which is Kanchana Banerjee. And she also has a website, kanchanabanerjee.com, where you can read more. And, you know, she constantly pushes out content out there. And all her books are available on Amazon and Flipkart. Okay, Vaishnavi has a question. Ma'am, who is your favorite author of the recent time?
Okay, so there are quite a few. Fiona Barton's thrillers are very well written. Peter Swanson. Mary Kubica's thrillers I love. Of course, Gillian Flynn, absolutely. Then Jane Harper's Dry and some other books, yeah. So, really, I mean, there are lots of, I can't, very difficult to pick one favorite. But if you ask me to pick one favorite, then I think my biggest favorite is Gillian Flynn. I really like her dark novels and I think she's a brilliant writer. She's just mind-blowing. So, yeah, she's my number one favorite.
I'm kind of curious, how many books do you read in a year? Like, how many books do you go through? Because I
I mean,
always
see, you know,
read.
I'm actually a very slow reader. I'm not a very fast reader because you know, I take time with my books, and I read not just for enjoyment. I read to learn and improve as a reader. So, you know, there are books that kind of, you know, I go slowly and I appreciate the language, the plot, the structure, how you know, how the author is introducing new characters, is building suspense. So all that. So actually, I'm not a very fast. So I can't really put a number to how many books I read. But yeah, I read a lot. Yeah.
All right. Sujata is saying it's a bold step to go for self-publishing.
Thank you, Sujata. Sujata is another very good friend. We often chat on WhatsApp about our writing journey. And yeah, thank you, Sujata.
All right. So thank you, ma'am, for, you know, being a part of this and giving us your time and patience and everything. And, you know, we had a lovely chat, and I'm sure everyone who's joined in would agree with that.
Thank
so,
you.
Yeah, thank you again. And we wish you all the best for your next book. We can't
thank
wait
you.
To read it. And, yeah, so thank you so much. And thank you,
thank
everyone,
you
for
so
joining.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for joining, and thank you for inviting me. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.